Hello everyone, this is Nitpick Nerd, and today I want to review episode 6 of season 3 of Star Trek Discovery, called Scavengers, and I think it was a better than average episode, with far fewer things that annoyed me than usual. There still were some things which I think are big continuity mistakes, even internal continuity problems in the episode itself, which is hard to even come up with excuses to explain it, and so those are the types of mistakes that really piss me off. When it's so self-contradictory, you cannot even invent a theory to try to explain it somehow. But the episode also had a few things which I actually liked, and some good references, and there were also, as always, a few scenes which are kind of borrowing ideas from other movies. But in this case, it was only a little bit. It was not done to something so unique of any one movie, meaning there are certain things that were in some famous movies, but those are kind of movie tropes, which are common in a lot of shows and movies, and so I can't really complain about it. I would say it was probably more of a homage than a ripoff, and some of them might have been a total coincidence. And in terms of special effects and action scenes, it looked pretty decent. There were some nice shots, and the episode begins by showing us that the Discovery has been refitted and upgraded to current technology, which is something I was saying this show must do as soon as possible, because that's the only way to make it logical how they can ever stand against ships of this time period, because they are such an old ship, and yet somehow they're able to face off against enemies in this season. And so that was something that was constantly annoying me, and I kept saying, why don't they simply say that they're upgrading their ship and adding new technology to it, and that will allow them to use whatever fancy technology they want to show off in this show. And so they finally did it, and the episode begins by showing us that they've reconstructed the Discovery into a modern ship using this programmable matter, and we also finally see those new droids which we saw in the intro, who are really similar to the ones Discovery already had from the previous season, but these are better, I guess. And its head is kind of detached from its body and yet sticking next to it, so that's kind of like, you know, BB-8 in Star Wars, only with a gap in between. And that's the kind of technology they showed from the start of the season, when they showed us flying tables and chairs. And I actually kind of like that, because that does look futuristic and plausible for this time period. And they showed us that some ships also have parts of the ship not touching, meaning they are held together by some kind of entanglement or something like that, which I guess cannot be easily broken by outside forces with against the will of the ship. So maybe it is perfectly safe to use it, and so I don't actually mind that. And also visually, it kind of reminds me of that movie Flight of the Navigator, which I really loved as a kid, and it also had that spaceship which could shapeshift and it could detach parts of itself, and they were floating next to the ship without problems. And so I actually kind of like that special effect, and because this is all in the far future, I think it is plausible. The problem with the nacelles being detached is a little bit more difficult to accept, because as we know from the previous Star Trek shows, the warp core is not in the nacelles, it's in the drive section, and it creates warp plasma, which then goes into the nacelles. And so how exactly can they be detached? How does the warp plasma get to them? I guess maybe with advanced transporters it's possible to simply teleport all of that to the nacelles. And even back in the 22nd century it was possible to transport warp plasma using a transporter. We saw that in an episode of Enterprise when they were at that automatic repair station, and as payment for the repairs they transported a canister of warp plasma to that station. And so it is possible to teleport it, and so maybe they simply teleport it from the warp core into the nacelles, or maybe in this time period each nacelle has its own little warp core. I think it makes sense, especially in the context of the whole risk of warp cores exploding again. They said that's still a possibility, so it would actually make sense to keep that in the nacelles itself, so that it will be easier to eject them, or simply to put shields between the ship and the nacelles, and that way you will protect the ship if suddenly the warp cores again explode. So it would make sense not to have the warp core in the middle of your own ship. So maybe that's how it works now. Maybe each nacelle has its own little warp engine, and so the nacelles are like their own little ship, which also carries the main hull of the ship to where they want to go. And so I'm willing to accept that. I don't think it's a huge issue, and I do think it makes sense for why the ship would be more maneuverable with this, because you know, the ship jumps to warp into the direction that the nacelles are pointed at, and so every time you have to change course, you have to move the whole ship, and the ship is a big and heavy thing, so you cannot instantly turn it into any direction. But if you detach the nacelles, which are much smaller and lighter, it will be easier to simply point the nacelles into any direction you want in the whole 3D space. It's not just about left or right. You can also point them down or up. And if you activate them, I guess it can still take the ship to any direction you want, even if the ship itself hasn't turned toward the same side yet. And so I do think that would improve maneuverability and the speed that they can jump into warp at any direction much quicker, and maybe even change direction mid warp flight, which is something that the book's ship also seems to be doing every time it flies at warp. For some reason, it's not in a straight line, but it's kind of doing a weird course, which is curved for some reason. So maybe these are simply the new rules of warp travel. It's more efficient this way, maybe. And I presume it's much faster than anything we've seen before. So having the detached nacelles would be an advantage if you have to do these maneuvers inside of a warp field more quickly, and that will be more effective. And also it will make it safer if suddenly you have to eject the nacelles. You can simply detach them and put shields between the ship and them immediately. And maybe you can even use the nacelles as a weapon of last resort if you don't have any other choice to save your ship. Maybe you can simply launch the nacelles as kind of a rocket toward your enemy at warp speed and to have it explode ahead of you while leaving the ship intact. I think that could be a cool shot. Maybe they'll do that later in the season, maybe in the last battle scene, I guess, of the season. Probably they'll do something like that. So that might be very cool. And the only real issue I have with this redesign is that it seems to contradict what we saw in the short trek Calypso, because it's taken place after all of this, and yet the nacelles didn't seem like they're detached in that short trek, even though I guess maybe they can be reattached if needed. And the biggest goof is that this new redesign, they also added the letter A to the registry number of the ship, which is not how it worked in the old movies and shows, but I could buy this because maybe Starfleet is trying to hide the fact that this ship is from the past, because that will be a violation of the Interstellar Treaty banning that, and so maybe they're wanting to hide that fact, and so they're pretending as if it's a new ship. So I don't actually mind that, but the problem is that in the short trek it did not have the A, and it's supposed to be taking place after, so why did they erase the A later? I guess the only way to explain all of this would be to send the ship back in time and to remove all these upgrades and to reattach the nacelles and to erase that A and hide the ship somewhere in the past for some reason. Maybe they need to send someone to the past and then they'll get the ship back in the future by simply hiding it somewhere, and then they'll simply find it in that place in the future. And this way they won't have to jump the whole show another 1,000 years into the future. They can simply send it back for whatever reason they need to do it. Maybe send one character back, maybe Felipia would be my guess. And they'll tell the computer to then hide the ship in that nebula and simply wait for them to return to it in the future. And just in case someone finds it, they don't want anyone to find the future tech, so maybe they'll simply remove all that stuff, and so they'll restore the ship to how it used to be before getting it back in the future. That will be my guess of how they can fix it, and so I wouldn't yet say this is a continuity issue before they actually get to it. And so maybe they will explain all of it, and then that will be fine. And it will also explain why the holograms in that short trek looked like the ones from the previous seasons of Discovery and not the more advanced holograms that should exist now. Even though when he was dancing with that hologram he still touched it, but it's unclear if he simply pretended as if he can touch it or not, and in one scene he can pass through that hologram after he paused it, and so it was kind of unclear if it's a more advanced hologram from this time period or if it could be the same as the other holograms. And speaking of holograms, the crew also get new badges which can have their own holographic controls, and the crew is all very amazed by that. My first thought is, why only now they're getting it? They said that it took 3 weeks for the ship to get upgraded, and so why only now they're giving this kind of technology to start to train on it? And they're all very amazed by that, which is something I like. I like the fact that, you know, seeing the characters amazed by the brand new technology they're seeing, that is something that I like in science fiction. The minor issue I have with this is that they shouldn't really be amazed by these holograms, because they had them back in the 23rd century as well, including holographic controls which they could touch in mid-air and all of that. So it's exactly the same technology that they already had before, even though they shouldn't have had it in the 23rd century. I made lots of videos about that and I complained about that, but they did have them in the continuity of the show, and so why are they now behaving as if they never saw such holograms before and suddenly they're so excited by this? But maybe they're excited by the fact that it's simply mobile, that they have it in their comm badge, not the holograms itself. And also they said they also have not only the communicator but also a tricorder and the personal transporter. Everything is in this one comm badge, Which makes sense because it's in the far future, but I think for a show it was always cool to have a lot of props and gadgets simply because it made it more believable for one, and second, it's just fun to see all this equipment, you know, what fans like to dress up with, to have, you know, your phaser, your tricorder, your communicator, all that stuff is kind of fun, and so putting it all just in one small, not so interesting gadget like a comm badge, and everything is just in that one thing, that's kind of simply less interesting for a show. It's a good thing they didn't say that their weapons are also in that comm badge and that it will be firing automatically at their enemies and all of that, so I think it's kind of a little bit overpowered to have everything in one thing, which is so small, and so it's simply less interesting. I like tricorders, I like, you know, even the medical tricorder and the normal tricorder, I like all that lore of all those technical tools and all of that, and so by removing all of them, I think it might make the show and future shows simply less interesting if you have it all in just one device. And also, I think they can easily be disarmed of everything at once this way. If someone simply takes away their comm badge or it falls off, then they're completely without anything else to work with, and so that's also a problem, I think. And they also show that their controls now have that 3D programmable matter on them, and so it looked a little bit silly, like it makes no sense what exactly is better about all of this, but I liked how the crew was excited by all of this, and so that did feel nice for a change to see the crew actually being excited about something new. And maybe it almost redeems this show a little bit, because at least it makes it worthwhile for the crew to have started out in the past and only now get to the future, because this way they are all excited, and if they were all from the future from the beginning, we wouldn't have all these nice moments now, and so in a way it almost kind of redeems the problems I had with the show earlier. And of course, from this point on, every time they want to show us that this ship has all kinds of advanced technology, I wouldn't be able to complain about it now, because now they have an excuse for it. Now it will be the opposite. Now I'll be complaining, why don't you use this and that, because you got upgraded and yet you still use the old technology. So now it will be the opposite problem. Now, the biggest problem I had with this episode is the fact that Bookship arrives at Starfleet headquarters. So I guess Michael gave him the super duper secret location of Starfleet headquarters, and his ship arrives there, and then she gets a transmission from him in which he told her that he goes somewhere to find one of the black boxes of the old Starfleet, which Michael was looking for, in order to figure out where the burn originated from, which is an idea I actually kind of like, and I'll get to that later. But the problem I had in this scene is that she said that it was recorded 3 weeks ago, and he said in the transmission that he will send the ship to her in 24 hours, meaning if he doesn't come back to his ship, it's automatically programmed to fly to her location in 24 hours. And yet it took 3 weeks for the ship to get there. And yet later in this same episode, she takes the same ship and flies to his location and back again in less than 12 hours. And there's really no way to explain this, because it's not as if they only picked up the transmission, then I'll be able to say maybe the transmission took longer to reach them than the ship itself can reach them, or maybe if he didn't say that it will go there in 24 hours, then I could say maybe the ship waited for longer, or if Michael didn't say that it's from 3 weeks ago, then also I wouldn't have any complaint. And so that's what I mean when I say this show has kind of self-contradictory dialogue like this, which makes it impossible to even explain it using wild theories. There is literally no way for me to explain it, except inventing some things off-screen which happened, like maybe Michael stole some Benamite crystals from Starfleet and that allowed her to go much faster on that ship than it could do previously without those crystals, because in episode 1 Book did mention that this ship can fly in slipstream, but he needs those crystals which no one has, and so if they simply added a line that Michael borrowed a few of those crystals from some other Starfleet ships or something, and that's what she uses to get there faster on his ship, then that will be okay, but no such line exists, so it's all pure speculation, and as it stands, it's a self-contradiction in this episode which makes no sense. So that's why this is the most annoying thing for me, and especially since they could easily be avoided, simply don't say 3 weeks, or don't say 24 hours, or simply don't say that this episode is inside of a 12-hour window. Simply leave at least some of those numbers ambiguous, and then we will fill up the rest in a logical way, but no, they gave numbers to each of these and then they don't fit together and it makes no sense. So I guess the only theory is to say that she actually used the slipstream drive with crystals that she got from Starfleet, and that's how she was able to get to him faster than he could. And another way to explain that would say that maybe he programmed his ship to take the long route and not in a straight line, maybe to avoid anyone following him and finding Starfleet headquarters. Maybe his ship was programmed to go in many different directions before going back and getting there so that no one can follow it, to protect that secret. And so again, if they simply mentioned that in the dialogue, then there would be no problem, but they didn't. Also, in the end of the episode, when they escape that planet and that Andorian guy is wounded, and Michael tells Book that she already alerted Discovery's sickbay about their arrival. And this is moments after they arrived, because we see this wounded Andorian. And she immediately tells Book that she alerted the Discovery's sickbay already. So that means communication between these two locations is almost instant. And so how did the transmission get through that distortion field, and how did it get into the Discovery itself, which is inside the distortion field, all from the location of this planet? And isn't that risky? Cannot anyone follow that transmission? And how did she even take Book's ship from inside that bubble of Starfleet headquarters without anyone noticing? I know it has a cloaking device, but ships have to pass through that field in and out, and so how come no one noticed that she stole it? So all of these kinds of things kind of make the show lose points for me, because it's kind of stupid writing, and it didn't have to be. That's why it's so annoying. They simply could have not said those specific lines which created the problem, or said them differently, or invent an excuse to explain them. As for Michael's betrayal of Saru once again, the most annoying thing is that it keeps happening every single episode, and yet he still trusts her for some reason. Like, he cannot predict her behavior, even though it's so obvious what she's going to do, and yet it never occurs to him, and so he doesn't even check, keep an eye on her to make sure she doesn't steal that ship again. And you know, the shuttle bay is always open in this ship, and so obviously she just took the ship somehow and no one noticed. And Saru is later surprised by this, and so I'm kind of more annoyed at Saru than at Michael, because it makes him look stupid. As for her behavior, I'll get to that later, but she didn't only do it to save Book, but also because she wanted that third black box of a Starfleet ship. And the most annoying thing about this is that we are supposed to believe that no one else in the entire galaxy for 120 years since the burn, no one else bothered to investigate this, no one else checked the black boxes of the ship, no one else figured out what she now figured out in 1 year, that the burn didn't happen everywhere at once, and therefore she can triangulate where it came from, if it was some kind of, I guess, maybe an explosion of an Omega particle somewhere in the galaxy. And so by triangulating the differences in the time when it happened, she'll be able to figure out where it came from. Well, one problem with that is that with only three boxes, she does have three locations in space, but it's not enough to pinpoint any exact area in the galaxy. You would need at least another one to add that extra dimension. Otherwise, you can only find a spot on a flat surface, but not really in 3D. I guess it can still give her a general direction, but it wouldn't be enough to really pinpoint anything. And also, time is not really constant everywhere in the galaxy anyway, meaning, you know, if a ship is closer to a gravity well or near a black hole, then time would be moving slightly slower on that ship compared to other ships which are farther away from gravity wells or moving at a slower speed. And so time is not exactly the same everywhere in the galaxy, and so of course there will be some variance, and so that doesn't prove anything about the burn, unless she took what I said into consideration, and maybe she did some super duper calculations by knowing where the ship was at that time, and she counteracted all the things I mentioned, and still it had that variance, then maybe she will have a point. But it will still annoy me how come she's the only one in the whole galaxy who figures this out. No one else for 120 years ever thought of studying all of this. And why are the black boxes so rare? We see so much wreckage of all these old ships all over the galaxy in the graveyards of ships. So how come more of them didn't have black boxes which were still working? And so that's something that also doesn't make any sense. And she left the cat on the Discovery before taking the Book's ship, and she leaves it in Tilly's quarters, and then we have a scene of Tilly and the cat, and it's supposed to be funny. And you know, I don't mind that, I love cats and all of that, but it doesn't really serve any purpose in the story. This whole cat thing is in the show just to be cute, just so fans will like it more. And I don't mind just cute scenes for no reason, simply for being there, but it doesn't really have any kind of purpose. And I know some people will bring up Spot in TNG, you know, Data had a cat and all of that, but I think in TNG the cat was a very necessary component in Data's character development because it was meant to humanize him, to show him caring for an animal like a human and bonding with the animal and all of that. So it did have a purpose in the story, in that show. It wasn't there just to be a cute scene. And yet here, this whole thing with the cat is just here to improve ratings, I guess. And I don't really mind it so much, but I did find it cringe-worthy how all the characters always are making fun of the cat's weight. Like, the cat is really fat, and they all make jokes about it. And I kept thinking, you know, if this was a person, then this would be very politically incorrect, but maybe that's why they made it a cat, and this way they can tell childish fat jokes all the time, and that would be okay because it's about a cat. And the most silly thing is when Tilly made that kind of joke. When she asked the cat, did she eat Michael Burnham? Strange coming from a person who, you know, probably maybe experienced some fat shaming herself. When she was a kid, I think they said in the early seasons that she wasn't popular at school, that other kids made fun of her and all that kind of stuff. So should she be the person to make fat jokes against the cat? So all of this is kind of, you know, I'd be fine if just one character did that all the time, but we have multiple characters, every single character talking about the cat has to make some kind of fat joke about the cat. And so I think that got old pretty fast. And also it was strange how Michael was able to use a device that Book carries that he used to find the cat. She reverse engineers it to find him, but he's in that prison, so why does he still have that device? Are you telling me that no one scanned Book to make sure he doesn't have any tracking devices on himself? No one bothered to check that, and so Michael was able to use his cat finder to find him instead, and so that was a little bit silly. And we also see this new Orion villain who kind of reminds me of Ramsay Bolton from Game of Thrones because he's kind of sadistic, and he sends his prisoners to try to escape as he shoots them, and then their heads blow up, just like in The Running Man, which had a prison with that kind of fence, and everybody were wearing those collars which can explode if someone tries to escape. And this is an idea that was used in a lot of movies and shows, and so I don't really mind that, but you know, visually, the way everything looked in this episode was really similar to The Running Man, and so I think probably it wasn't a coincidence, and this villain is really similar to Ramsay Bolton. Just the way he looks, you know, he puts his hand on the shoulder of that guy that he's about to send to try to escape, just like Ramsay did with Jon Snow's brother in that scene in Game of Thrones. And so a lot of little similarities like that, which I think are probably not a coincidence, but maybe they are. We also have a scene of a flying droid, and it looks really similar to those sentient robots in the movie Batteries Not Included, which is another movie I loved as a kid. And there was a scene in that movie of someone taking a pipe and hitting that flying robot and almost killing it, and we have a similar scene here with Michael doing that. And maybe it's a complete coincidence, but I suspect it might have been a homage because, you know, this flying droid even has those glowing eyes, just like in that movie. It's also funny how the body of this droid kind of looks similar to Picard's ship in Star Trek Picard. It's kind of a similar design to that. But of course the difference between Batteries Not Included and this is that in that movie it actually meant something. That whole scene had some kind of emotional impact because, you know, the movie got us to love those robots. They were characters, they had sentience, and watching someone beat one of them up was actually, you know, emotional for me watching it as a small kid. I remember that was kind of a horrific scene of watching someone beat up that robot. I remember as a kid it affected me almost as much as the beating of Johnny Five in the movie Short Circuit 2. And so maybe that's why I remember this scene so well, because that was traumatic for me watching as a kid. And so seeing something similar here immediately reminded me of that. Only here it doesn't have any meaning because we don't know this robot. We don't know if it's sentient or not or whatever. And so we don't really care when she beats it up. And it's just there just as a special effect, just as an action scene, without any real purpose. And also it's kind of annoying how not advanced this robot is, because, you know, this is the 32nd century, so how come this flying droid doesn't have personal shields or a tractor beam or weapons or just the ability to dodge something that is about to hit it? You know, even those droids that we saw in season 1 of TNG in that planet when they had those flying droids and they could avoid phaser fire and they had their own shields and their own weapons. And here, this is a droid that belongs to these villains of the galaxy who terrorize everybody in the whole galaxy, and yet this droid doesn't have any defensive capabilities at all. And so that makes it look kind of not scary. Like, the villains are not really scary in this season. It's one of the problems so far that they mention all these amazing villains that Starfleet is scared of, and they have the technology of today. Like, they don't have any capability at all, it seems. And so the villains are really pathetic in this season. So we have this homage to Batteries Not Included, to the running man with the exploding head, with anyone who tries to pass that fence. Similarities to Game of Thrones with this Ramsay Bolton type of character. And in another scene we also have Philippia saying to Michael, "The things we do for love," which is also a line from Game of Thrones. And we also have that interview of Alex Kurtzman saying that he wants to make Star Trek more like Game of Thrones. And so that's why I'm inclined to believe all of this isn't a coincidence, but just a lack of imagination and creativity that they have to constantly imitate scenes from other movies and shows and make them less good. And so if you're trying to do a remake, I'm actually fine with that. If you improve something, if you make it better than how it was done before, then I will like it, but it's not better, it's worse. So what's the point of doing that? Also, they kind of borrow a joke from the Orville again with Linus, who is really similar to that alien with the big head on the Orville called Dan. And so here we have Linus, who is also kind of an awkward alien who is doing stupid things all the time, and so he accidentally transports himself to parts of the ship by mistake. And in the end of the episode, when Michael and Book are about to kiss, suddenly he appears in the elevator and interrupts that. And so that's the same kind of joke they had with Dan on the Orville, when they kept meeting him in the elevator all the time and he kept interrupting their conversations constantly. And so that seems like a recycled joke from the Orville, and it wasn't really that funny in my opinion. Now, they did have some correct references to the older Star Trek shows, like they mentioned the self-sealing stem bolts from Deep Space Nine. Now, we also see Adira in this episode, and she was helping to upgrade something in the spore drive that now Stamets won't have to hook up his hands into the spore drive. Now he can simply put his hands on that nano gel that she installed for him, and so he doesn't have to have those implants in his hands anymore. I don't have any problem with this, except the fact that they said in this same episode the Discovery is on a hot standby to be ready to jump at any moment. And so is it really the right time to do big changes to the spore drive? Because what if they suddenly have to jump and yet he removes his implants and we don't see them actually test the spore drive with this new nano gel and all of that? So what if suddenly there's some kind of mistake and it doesn't work? That would be very stupid. And so why did they have to do it exactly when they're on such a standby to be ready to jump at any moment? I don't think that was the right moment to do these kinds of changes. And also, we don't see them test it. I guess it might have happened off screen. And so, again, that's something that they could have fixed with one short line of dialogue, and then it won't be a problem. Now, back on the prison planet, there was a scene which I thought might be a continuity mistake, so I went back and checked, but it's not really a mistake when he tells Michael that the black box that he found is in his quarters, that she just needs to get it and go. So at first I thought he means that it's on the ship itself, and yet later we see that it's in his sleeve, and so I thought that's a continuity mistake. But then we see that the Andorian guy gave it to him, so presumably he got it from his quarters and gave it to him before they escaped. And yet when he originally said that to her, that it's in his quarters, I think maybe she could also have misunderstood it, that maybe it's on the ship and not in his quarters in the prison itself. So that was an unnecessary kind of continuity question mark I had during the episode. And as for that Andorian, they said that someone hacked off his antennas, and yet we saw in Enterprise that their antennas grow back again by themselves. And so why doesn't he simply grow them back? I guess either it just happened recently and so he just didn't have enough time to grow them back, or maybe they did something to him so that it won't grow back. So I don't really have a huge problem with that. Again, with the new medical technology, they can basically do whatever they want now, and it's easy to come up with an explanation. That's why I didn't have a problem with Adira being able to carry a Trill. So maybe when they cut off the Andorian's antennas, they also did something to prevent it from growing back, and so it's not really a huge issue. Also, a small continuity problem is that those weapons that the villains have, sometimes they vaporize people, other times they only injure people. And when they shot this Andorian, it only wounded him when it vaporizes other people. I guess they simply need this Andorian later on in the season, and so that's why he has this plot armor, and they take him with him, and they mention something about him rallying people against that crime syndicate. So I guess maybe later on, when he regains his confidence and he'll help them rally the whole galaxy together in the end of the season or something like that, As for the whole relationship between Michael and Book, I think it's ridiculous to expect the audience to believe that they were not together before, that they were simply friends, even though they were together for so long, on adventures all the time, and yet they never hooked up until now. I think that's kind of ridiculous. And as for Michael violating orders again, at this point I think maybe she should just quit Starfleet. I mean, why not simply become a civilian and stay on the ship as a civilian? And then you can go away whenever you want. If you want to go on some special mission, then you'll always be able to do that as a kind of vigilante. And so why even stay in Starfleet if you're unable to follow the chain of command? If you don't understand that you're now a part of a kind of a military organization and you have to follow orders, if she cannot understand that, then maybe she should just be a civilian. And technically she can stay on the ship as a civilian. And she can be like an advisor or something, and then she can leave whenever she wants to do whatever she wants to do. I think that would be kind of logical for this kind of character who is simply incapable of listening to the chain of command. And so why is she in Starfleet for? Maybe they'll do that in the next episode. Maybe she'll quit Starfleet and become a civilian for a while before coming back later or whatever. So I guess we'll wait and see. So I don't want to prejudge all the things that they're setting up before knowing where they're going with all of this. Is this simply kind of another one of those cases of her violating orders and getting away with it, or if it's actually going to be some kind of character development and the story arc and all of that? So I guess we'll wait and see. So I don't want to prejudge all of this before seeing where they go with it. So I think this was mostly a decent episode. I didn't really hate a lot of things about it. I was annoyed by all the things I mentioned, but also liked a few scenes. And overall, I still think this season is an opportunity to kind of reboot the Star Trek universe into something good, if they do it in a clever way. But my biggest fear is that they don't seem to be paying attention to all the details, and so I'm really worried they will screw everything up again and nothing will make sense, and then it will ruin what could have been a good season. So I'm actually hoping for it to be good. I don't want to hate on the show. I want to enjoy it, because I'm going to keep watching it anyway, so I would rather to watch something I enjoy. And also I want to do a prediction for the next episode, which is called Unification Part 3. So I'm guessing in this episode Michael will unite the Romulans and Vulcans together again, you know, just like what Spock was trying to do, and yet apparently never got the chance to finish that, because he's thought to have been killed when he saved the Romulans from the supernova, or tried to save them and failed. And so I guess Michael will now finish what he started, and she'll do it in just one episode. You know, Spock stayed on Romulus to spend his remaining lifetime trying to do that and failed, but Michael will do it in just one episode. She will complete his life's mission of bringing the Romulans and Vulcans back together, and maybe they'll just become one species now, because, you know, maybe it's too confusing to have two species who kind of look the same, who have the same ears. And so, you know, maybe Kurtzman was confused by that, and so he asked the writers, you know, I'm really tired of trying to distinguish between these two species, it always confused me. Can you simply just unite them into one so that it'll be simpler in the future? So I suspect maybe that was the reason they want to do it, but maybe it will be nice. If it's done well, maybe it will be a nice way. Also, you know, it will be interesting to see a scene of Michael learning about Spock and what he accomplished later and all of that, and maybe that's why it will be personally important for her to finish what he started, as kind of completing his desires and all of that. So I guess we'll wait and see. So that's all I had to say about it for today. Let me know what you think, and we can discuss it in the comment section below. And I will see you all next time. Bye bye.